To love oneself is the beginning of a lifelong romance. On arriving in New York in 1882, I was asked, had I anything to declare? And I replied, I have nothing to declare except my genius. The gods had given me almost everything. I had genius, a distinguished name, high social position, brilliancy, intellectual daring. I made art a philosophy, and philosophy an art. There was nothing I said or did that did not make people wonder. Whatever I touched, I made beautiful. I was asked in Oxford, well, Oscar, what will you do with your life? And I replied, I won't be a dried up Oxford don anyhow. I'll be a poet, a writer, a dramatist. Somehow or other, I'll be famous. And if not famous, I'll be notorious. And I was certainly that. The taxman one time came to my house and he said, I am here about the taxes, Mr. Wilde. And I replied, taxes? Why should I pay taxes? But Mr. Wilde, you live here, you sleep here. Ah yes, but then you see, I sleep so badly. Fashion is what one wears oneself. What is unfashionable is what other people wear. One should either be a work of art or wear a work of art. One can never be overdressed or overeducated. In matters of grave importance, style, not sincerity, is the vital thing. To be great is to be misunderstood. A cynic is a man who knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. I was born at a very early age, in fact, in 1854, 21 Westland Road, just direct down the road here in Dublin. My parents moved up to number 1 Merrion Square when I was aged 1, although I don't actually recall it at the time. My father, Sir William Wilde, who had been knighted by Queen Victoria, was one of Dublin's great kind men. He founded the Eye and Ear Hospital for the poor people of Dublin, and he was a man never drunk, but seldom sober, and he liked his other women too. It was rumoured that in fact he was Jack the Ripper. What do you call a fish with a knife in it? Jack the Kipper. So, my mother, Lady Jane Francesca Wilde, otherwise known as Speranza. Speranza is an Italian word, and it means hope, and hope was for the Irish nation. She was a staunch nationalist and had founded the Irish Nationalist newspaper. She used to host these famous salons down in Merrion Square on a Saturday afternoon. And Bram Stoker used to attend, and great writers, dramatists, poets, writers. And I think this is where I developed my brilliant mind. One occasion I was asked that I could talk spontaneously on any subject, and somebody said to me, the Queen! And I replied, the Queen is not a subject. My wit and humour were so much part of my makeup that I often had audiences enthralled for hours. I knew and met everyone, including the Pope, and I commented, my walking stick was deeply impressed and it showed signs of budding. I was a riot wherever I went. I once said that nothing ages like happiness, and certainly mine age before the end of my unique and remarkable career. For 15 years I had enjoyed public acclaim as a poet, writer, dramatist, artist. I consorted with princes and showgirls, and I was sought after in the most fashionable circles of society for my masterful conversation. Ah, my first love, Florence Balcombe. Oh, I loved her. She was a real beauty queen from Marino in Dublin. We were together for over 2 years, and we used to walk in the park, and she'd link my arm, and I remember giving her a beautiful silver cross and chain. Again, 3 weeks later, she finished our relationship, but I asked for the cross and chain back. She later went on to marry Bram Stoker of Dracula fame. Bram Stoker was very good. He was my referee in Trinity College. And later on in my hour of need, he came all the way to Paris to give me some money. Some people said I was the Elvis Presley to literature. The Rolling Stones, when Mick Jagger sings the song Sympathy for the Devil, he wears his beautiful big flowing fur cape. Unfortunately, I can't afford one of those. But Mick comes out for Sympathy for the Devil. They were hugely influenced by myself, and Mick played me. And Marianne Faithfull, his latest girlfriend at the time, played Bosie, which you will hear about shortly. Keith Richards said on their drug bust, "We'll go in Wildian in Green Carnations." They wrote a song about me that got to number 12 in the American charts called We Love You, Oscar. U2 wrote a song about me also called Salome. It's a very fast, upbeat 10-minute song, and I've danced in my garage many times to that, and so have some people in this audience. But also, U2 bought the house for my father had, as I said, Sir William Wilde, in Cong and Mayo, beside Ashford Castle, which is now the top hotel in the world. And Bono likes to sit on the bed where I used to sleep in to inspire his writing. They wrote the song Salome, and also, as you will hear later, in the song Pride in the Name of Love, I will quote a word from that Bono has used from one of my masterful poems. Morrissey carries a picture of me, and David Bowie, being the Dorian Gray of rock. As you will hear at the interval, many changes happened in my life. If one plays good music, people don't listen. If one plays bad music, people don't talk. And thank you very much for the kind introduction. I wrote part of that myself. On discovering America, great success here. Nothing like it since Dickens, they tell me. I am torn in bits by society. Wonderful dinners, crowds wait for my carriage. I have a gloved hand, an ivory cane, and they cheer. In America, the only rational method of art criticism I ever saw was, please don't shoot the pianist, he is trying his best. Experience is the name everyone gives to their mistakes. After a good dinner, one can forgive anyone, even one's own relations. Pleasure is the only thing one should live for. And I see we're fortunate enough to be in the presence of a distant relation of Oscar Wilde's, as I call her, Lady Wilde, a very stylish woman indeed. Here's what some people said about me. Stephen Fry, for many years I have known that Oscar Wilde was one of the few major parts I might be lucky enough to be offered. I had been told this since I was quite young, and was told it with gathering frequency as my girth thickened and the flesh in my face began to record every plate of pasta and every glass of vodka and tonic that had been pushed through it. The Prince of Wales said at the time, not to have known Oscar Wilde was not to be known. George Best, one of the world's greatest footballers and Ireland's greatest, moved in London to my mother's house where there's a plaque outside. And he commented to Alex, he said, after he'd read the biography on my life by Richard Ellman, he said he wouldn't go to the toilet or sit in that seat, as he might pick up a disease from Oscar. That one's for you, Alex. Winston Churchill said, the one person I assuredly want to meet in the afterlife is Oscar Wilde. Michael Collins was forever to be heard quoting Oscar Wilde. Yeats, my first meeting with Oscar Wilde was an astonishment. I never heard a man to talk with such perfect sentences. Bono, the importance of being Oscar. George Bernard Shaw, all my work was due to the influence of Oscar Wilde. In a certain sense, Mr. Wilde is to me our only true playwright. He plays with everything, with wit, with philosophy, with drama, with the audience, with the whole theatre. A true fitting tribute from one Irish genius to another. The Bishop of London. I never knew a man who united in himself so many lovable and Christian virtues. Edgar, who included the following in his book, Oscar Wilde. Afterwards, we drove back to Chelsea. It was a vile night, bleak and bitter. On alighting, a man came up to me. He wore a short jacket, which he opened. From neck to waist, he was bare. I gave him a shilling. Then came the rebuke. With entire simplicity, Oscar took off his overcoat and put it about the man. But the simplicity seemed to me too Hugo-esque, and I said, why don't you ask him in to dinner, Oscar? And Oscar replied, dinner is not a feast, it is a ceremony. I never put off till tomorrow what I can possibly do the day after. Al Pacino. I have fallen in love with this great Irish writer. How he is able to mince such perfect words together. There is only one thing in the world worse than being talked about, and that is not being talked about. There's Lily. Ah, my Lily. I loved her, you know. I used to take her to the theatre and introduce her to fine wines. I would rather have discovered Lily Langtry than discovered America. And when Laura asked me to put this together, I asked her, what's your favourite Oscar Wilde quotation? And that's what she said. And it's in the first page of the world's favourite 100 quotes of Oscar Wilde. I think I see a few copies around the place. But I loved her. I took her to museums, introduced her to the Prince of Wales. I even wrote a play about her. Encouraged her to take up acting, and she captured all the hearts of all the men in upper Victorian society in just that black dress of her. I used to wait outside her house, you know, with a bunch of lilies, hence the name Lily Langtry. You know, she used to hunt, and they used to ride in those days. A lot of the ladies would sit down, you see, and they'd ride like that, side saddle. And then the men would ride like this, they'd be out hunting, they'd go, morning your lordship, morning your ladyship, morning the baroness. Ah, fox hunting. The unspeakable in pursuit of the unedible. This is a letter I wrote to Lily Langtry on the 22nd of January, 1884. My dear Lil, I am really delighted at your immense success. The most brilliant telegrams have appeared in the papers here on your performance in Pearl. You have done what no other artist of our day has done, invaded America a second time and carried off new victories. But then you are made for victory. It is always flashed in your eyes and rung in your voice. And so I write half to tell you how glad I am at your triumphs. You, Venus Victrix of our age, and the other half to tell you that I'm going to be married to a beautiful young girl called Constance Lloyd, a grave, slight, violet-eyed little Artemis, with great coils of heavy brown hair, which make her flower-like head droop like a flower, and wonderful ivory hands, which draw music from the piano so sweet that the birds stop to listen to her. We are to be married in April. I hope so much that you will be over then. I am so anxious for you to know and to like her. I am hard at work lecturing and getting quite rich, though it's hard being so much away from her. But we telegraph to each other twice a day and rush back suddenly from the uttermost parts of the earth to see each other for an hour and do all the foolish things which wise lovers do. In the movie Judge Roy Bean, Ava Gardner played Lily Langtry. This is what Lily said about me. He possessed a remarkable, fascinating personality. He had one of the most alluring voices that I had ever listened to, round and soft and full of variety and expression, and the cleverness of his remarks received added value from his manner of delivering them. In the 1920s at Lily Langtry's villa in Monaco, where she had kept an empty seat in memory of Oscar, somebody commented, "Oh, but he was a convicted homosexual," and she replied, "Oh, you don't know what you're talking about. Oscar was a very versatile man." The mystery of love is greater than the mystery of debt. Heartbreak, betrayal, and the unimportance of being Mrs. Oscar Wilde. She spoke out against war and the treatment of dockers. She and I marched in favor of the dockers. She said, "I wrote so many stories in such bursts of creation. I never had a malicious thought or feeling. It was my innocence that made me blind to the cruel intentions of others." She spoke French, read Italian, painted with skill, and went to college to study Shelley. An early feminist, she had bold, innovative ideas about fashion and interior design, and she wrote children's stories too. 7 months after our wedding, I wrote to Constant from Scotland. "I feel your fingers through my hair and your cheeks brushing mine. But this fashionable couple embarked on a dangerous path, believing in freedom and independence. Right from the beginning, they spent too much time apart. I had confessed to a friend that my romantic feelings had changed. Along came Lord Alfred Douglas, Bosie, as he was known." I remember my mother years ago, and I'm sure many people in the room, he was a real Bosie, that fella. Now you know where that came from. Bosie was a spoiled young aristocrat who had entered Oscar's life a fan and became his lover and destroyer. Wilde was smitten by the beautiful young man, but his passion turned into a fatal addiction. Poor Constance. Later, her eldest son Vivian remembered his mother in tears, pouring over masses of press cuttings. There is no doubt she was a great, brave woman who had married the wrong man, but loved Oscar just the same. Incidentally, her father died age 46 and had got caught up in a homosexual scandal. Keep love in your heart. A life without it is like a sunless garden when the flowers are dead. One time, going into a flower shop, I asked for several bunches of flowers to be removed from the window. "Oh, certainly, sir. How many would you like?" "Oh, I don't want any, thank you, but they do look rather tired." Welt. At all costs, one must have welt. When you're an Irishman in Victorian time and you're going into a London dinner party, I said to George Bernard Shaw, and to William Butler Yeats. When you go in, you must make a statement with your fashion or your dress sense. Me, as you can see in my flowing cloak, William Butler Yeats in his monocle, and George Bernard Shaw in his plus fours, which the golfers still used to wear. Golf is a good walk ruined, although I think Rory McIlroy does not have to worry about that swing. One time I was playing tennis, I used to go down to the south coast where I'd write my plays, and I was playing tennis, and I was completely naked with Bosie, and we were laughing and giggling, and three girls looked over, and they said, "Good God, what are you doing playing tennis naked?" And I turned and I said, "Pure Greek." Young men want to be faithful and are not. Old men want to be faithless and cannot. I remember coming from a funeral one time. I saw the poor lady and I commented. I could see the poor lady's hair turned to gold with grief. The picture of Dorian Gray in 1891. W.H. Smith refused to stop that filthy book. It's a Gothic horror, and Bram Stoker was quite influenced by it. He wrote Dracula 6 years after my brilliant novel. It's a Gothic horror novel and a disturbing tale of a young man's uncanny ability to remain both young and beautiful while descending into a life of heartless debauchery. Dorian sinks into a life of crime and gross sensuality. His body retains perfect youth and vigour, while his painted portrait, day by day, grows into a hideous record of evil, while he must keep hidden from the world. My scandalous bestseller was one of the most damning pieces of evidence used against me in the trial that brought down my downfall. And yet now it is on the English literature curriculum. It bearing your soul for eternal youth. Basil Hallward is what I think I am. Lord Henry is what the world thinks of me. Dorian Gray is what I would like to be. I represent to you all the sins you have never had the courage to commit. Lady Windermere's Fan, my first brilliant comedy, and as I had said earlier, I had written it for Lily. I came out from behind the curtain smoking a cigarette, and the crowd were going, "Author! Author!" Ladies and gentlemen, I have enjoyed this evening immensely. The actors have given us a charming rendition of a delightful play, and your intelligence has been most appreciative. I would like to congratulate you on the great success of your performance, which persuades me that you think almost as highly of the play as I do myself. I was asked one time, "What did you do today, Oscar?" And I said, "Oh, this morning I wrote a play to amuse myself, really. But in the afternoon, I went out and took a comma out." Groucho Marx and my influence on Groucho Marx. Groucho Marx, if you would come in here, the famous line, "Are you a member here?" "Oh, I would never join a club that would have me as a member." There was a film called The Day at the Races. Groucho Marx played Dr. Hackenabash. And he's there sitting down with a horse, and he has his long doctor's coat on. And he's sitting down, and he's there at the stethoscope. The horse is there, and he's sitting down. He's listening to the horse's heartbeat. He gives the horse, anyway, a tablet. But it's about that size. He says, "Take one of those every 2 furlongs. So the horse, anyway, goes off. But the secretary then comes in, big, busty, blonde one. And in she comes, anyway, and she goes, Dr. Hackenbash, Dr. Hackenbash, I need your okay for this. And he says, can't you see I'm really busy? I'll give you the O now, but come back later for the K. And if you could just, if Madonna's people are watching, no, could you send that to the publicist and just put a little note to Madonna saying, this is how you take off a cloak. And perhaps on our next tour, if I'm available, we can get into rehearsal. And I'll write on the back of the bill, I love you, Madonna, from Patrick Walsh. To get into society nowadays, you either amuse people or shock people. That is all. No dinner party or opening night was complete until I was in attendance. No man has any real success in this world unless women back him and women rule society. I dominated Victorian society from 1891 to 1895 and ended up being the central figure in London. A woman of no importance, my witty comedy of social scandal focuses on the hypocrisy of a society which smears and mocks women for their sexual behaviours while praising men for theirs. My brilliant comedy delves into the dark side of English upper class society, where all is to be revealed. I was poking fun at upper English class society. When I watch Downton Abbey, or even Benidorm, they're forever quoting me. Downton Abbey is more like one of the plays I wrote. Even in one scene, Lord Grantham said when they were having a dinner party, well, we're not going to have Oscar Wilde here. An ideal husband and the importance of being earnest. At the height of my success, they both opened in 1895. An ideal husband is about a trade secret being sold and a politician being blackmailed by a woman. The world is a stage. The play is badly cast. Politicians, there's not a single person in the House of Commons worth painting, though perhaps a few could do with a little whitewashing. It is better to be spoken of than spoken to. Criticism is the highest form of autobiography. Only dull people are brilliant at breakfast. Who, being loved, is poor? Here's what I said on the importance of being earnest. My masterpiece, considered the greatest comic play written in the history of literature. It is exquisitely trivial, a delicate bubble of fancy, and it has its philosophy that we should treat all trivial things of life very seriously, and all the serious with sincere and studied triviality. The play is a success. The only question is whether the first night's audience will be. I was going to change a few words in it, and the Prince of Wales said, no, Oscar, don't change a single word. I have put only my talent into my life. I put all my genius into my life. Exercise, the only possible exercise is to talk, not to walk. The one way to get rid of temptation is to yield to it. Genius is born, not paid. Clever people never listen, and stupid people never talk. The truth is rarely pure and never simple. I heard that quoted on Benidorm. A man who would call a spade should be compelled to use one. This is a love letter to Bosie. Every great love has its tragedy, and now ours has too. But to have known and loved you with such profound devotion, to have had you for a part of my life, the only part I now consider beautiful, is enough for me. My passion is at a loss for words. But you can understand me, you alone. Our souls were made for one another, and by knowing yours through love, mine has transcended many evils, understood perfection, and entered into the divine essence of things. I never travel anywhere without my diary. One should always have something sensational to read on the train. In this world, there are two tragedies. One is not getting what one wants, and the other is getting it. I am not English. I am Irish, which is quite another thing. At the time, in Victorian time, in the 1890s, a lot of the gays wear a green carnation and a little ring, which was their little disguise in the theatre. And when I'd be at my plays, you'd see them in all the various boxes spread around the theatre. I was the great self-publicist, you know. Sometimes I could be seen in a theatre jumping out of a box. Then, 20 metres later, jumping out of another, people used to say, "Who is that madman?" But the self-publicity was needed. The love that dare not speak its name. It is a reference to homosexual love, although Oscar denied this in his defence. Lord Alfred Douglas Bosey coined the phrase in his poem, Two Loves. I am the love that dare not speak its name. Of course, Oscar and Douglas had good reason to be cautious about the relationship, as homosexual love was a criminal offence in England in the 19th century. Bosey introduced them to all these brothels and rent boys, and Oscar described it as like feasting with panthers. Oscar, on the love that dare not speak its name, which he said when he was put in the box in court. It is beautiful. It is fine. It is the noblest form of affection. There is nothing unnatural about it. It is intellectual, and it repeatedly exists between an elder man and a younger man. When the elder man has all the intellect, and the younger man has all the joy, hope, and glamour of life before him. That it should be so, the world does not understand. The world mocks at it and sometimes puts one in the pillory for it. When he said that in court, he got a round of applause, but he got some booing as well. Work is the curse of the drinking classes. A heavenly wine should be drunk kneeling. Some people cause happiness wherever they go, others whenever they go. We Irish are too poetical to be poets. We are a nation of brilliant failures, but the greatest talkers since the Greeks. I like to do all the talking myself. It's one of my greatest pleasures. I often have long conversations all by myself, and sometimes I am so clever I don't understand a single word of what I've been saying. The old believe everything, the middle-aged suspect everything, and oh yes, the young know everything. I am hard at work being idle. There is no sin except stupidity. You know, I was Ireland's first great export. Guinness was our second, and you too was our third. A man's face is his autobiography. A woman's face is pure work of fiction. Youth is the one thing worth having. I like men who have a future and women who have a past. No man should have a secret from his wife. She invariably finds out. Be yourself. Everyone else is taken. The Marquess of Queensbury. I'm sure you've heard of the Queensbury rules. He was the 9th Marquess of Queensbury, a hot-headed, violent Scotsman. And he had a hatred for Oscar Wilde. His son, Bosie, also had a hatred for his father. His younger son had had a homosexual affair with Lord Rosebery. Lord Rosebery at the time was the Secretary of State. And the Marquess of Queensbury had called up to Oscar Wilde's house one day, and he said, he was let in by his butler, and he came in with a prize fighter. And he said, "You will cease all this friendship with Posey. You are a poser and a punce and a queer." And Oscar stood up and he said, "The Oscar Wilde rules are to shoot on sight." And he grabbed his cane and broke it down. He called his butler in and he said, "This is the infamous Marquess of Queensbury. Show him out and never let him back in." The Marquess of Queensbury had whipped a cabinet minister in front of the Prince of Wales. And his son had committed suicide over the homosexual relationship, his younger son. So he had this intense hatred that something was going to happen, Bosie and Oscar. This is my theory. And on the opening of The Importance of Being Earnest and an Ideal Husband, he went with a prize fighter with bouquets of vegetables to try and have the performances disrupted. But Oscar had got wind of this and said, "At police on all the entrances," so he couldn't get in. There is more brass than brains in the aristocracy. He has no enemies, but is intensely disliked by his friends. Lady Wilde to Oscar in his time of troubles, "If you stay," Lady Wilde told him, "even if you go to prison, you will always be my son. It will make no difference to my affection. But if you go, I will never speak to you again." Oscar replied, his fight was against English hypocrisy. He was in a hotel waiting to be arrested. And the police, when arresting Oscar, they came in and said, "Do you know who I am?" And Oscar replied, "This man does not know who he is." A letter to Bosie before going to jail. "My heart is a rose which your love has brought to bloom. My life is a desert fanned by the delicious breeze of your breath. Good looks are a snare that every man would like to be caught in." George Bernard Shaw, at the time, he had a boat ready for Oscar. There was no extradition, so they could have gone off to France, but Oscar refused. He wanted to stand up and fight. But all the Green Carnation Brigade, 600 to 700 of them, they were all set to leave for France to avoid being arrested. The problem with Oscar Wilde, the way of his upbringing, a man of his, a solicitor warned him, he said, "You'll last 6 to 7 months in prison. And if you get hard labour, which is a lot more difficult than just a prison sentence, it might only be 5 months. Edward Carson, who Oscar went to college with across here in Trinity, and they were quite good friends, and he said, "Old Ned is going to try this case." The three trials of Oscar Wilde, a tragedy in three acts really, and the first true celebrity trial, and they take an important place in legal history. Is there any legal people in the room? Okay.
Illegal.
The first trial opened on Wednesday, 3rd of April, 1895. The second trial on Friday, 26th of April, 1895. And the third trial on Monday, 20th of May, 1895. 5 days later, Oscar Wilde was sentenced to 2 years hard labour. The judge, Justice Wills, before passing sentence, described it as the worst trial he had ever tried. It later emerged that, in fact, the judge was homosexual. History has proven that an Irishman does not get justice in an English courtroom, and that's no offence to English people. On a lighter note, Oscar Wilde's duel of wits with Edward Carson, the greatest cross-examiner of his day, showed the true brilliance of Oscar. You are of the opinion, I believe, that there is no such thing as an immoral book. Oscar replied, yes. May I take it that you think the priest and the acolyte was not immoral? Oscar, it was worse. It was badly written. The judge, before passing sentence, and here it is word for word, it is no use for me to address you. People who can do these things must be dead to all sense of shame, and one cannot hope to produce any effect upon them. It is the worst case I have ever tried. That you, Taylor, kept a kind of male brothel, it is impossible to doubt. And that you, Wilde, have been the centre of a circle of extensive corruption of the most hideous kind among young men, it is equally impossible to doubt. I shall, under the circumstances, be expected to pass the severest sentence that the law allows. In my judgment, it is totally inadequate for such a case. The sentence of the court is that each of you to be imprisoned and kept to hard labour for 2 years. At the train station, awaiting transport to Reading Jail, Oscar uttered his famous line, "If this is the way Queen Victoria treats her prisoners, she does not deserve to have any." Oscar Wilde on prison life. On November the 13th, 1895, I was brought down here from London from 2 o'clock till 2:30. On that day, I had to stand on the centre platform of Clapham Junction in convict dress and handcuffed for the world to look at. I had been taken out of the prison hospital ward without a moment's notice being given to me. Of all possible objects, I was the most grotesque. When people saw me, they laughed. Each train, as it came up, swelled the audience. Nothing could exceed their amusement. That was, of course, before they knew who I was. As soon as they had been informed, they laughed still more. For 30 minutes, I stood there in the grey November rain, surrounded by a jeering mob, and one of the commuters spat in my face. For a year after that was done to me, I wept every day at the same hour and for the same space of time. To those who are in prison, tears are a part of every day's experience. A day in prison on which one does not weep is a day on which one's heart is hard, not a day on which one's heart is happy. Prison turns a man's heart to stone. And there's a giant quotation of mine in Kilmainham Jail. I had lost my name, my position, my happiness, my freedom, and my wealth. I was a prisoner and a pauper. But I still had my children left. Suddenly, they were taken away from me by the law. It was a blow so appalling that I did not know what to do, and said, "The body of a child is as the body of the Lord. I am not worthy of either." That moment seemed to save me. Some 6 weeks ago, I was allowed by the doctor to have white bread to eat instead of the coarse black or brown bread of ordinary prison fare. It is a great delicacy. Can you imagine stale brown bread being a delicacy? It will sound strange that dry bread could possibly be such a delicacy. To me, it's so much so that at the close of each meal, I carefully eat whatever crumbs may be left on my tin plate or have fallen on the rough towel that one uses as a cloth so as not to soil one's table. And I do so not from hunger. I get now quite sufficient food, but simply in order that nothing should be wasted of. What is given to me, so one should look on love. This comes from De Profundis. It's a long letter explaining my downfall and to Bosie. And it comes from the depth of the soul. It's a Greek word. I had two copies made because I knew when I'd give it to Bosie, he'd throw it in the fire. The second copy I left in my will, which was to be given to the British Museum in 1950. And my loyal friend Robert Ross, who later was, his ashes were spread in my tomb. Suffering is one long moment. We cannot divide it by seasons. We can only record its moods and chronicle their return. For us, there is only one season, the season of sorrow. The very sun and moon seem taken from us. Now, I am completely penniless and absolutely homeless. Yet, there are worse things in the world than that. I am quite candid when I say that rather leave this prison with bitterness in my heart against the world, I will gladly and readily beg my bread from door to door. Those who have much are often greedy. Those who have little always share. Where I walk, there are thorns. Behind my prison's blinded bars, I do possess what none can take away. Nelson Mandela said, what kept him going in prison was the Oscar Wilde quotation. We are all in the gutter, but some of us are looking at the stars. In America, the president reigns for 4 years, but journalism governs forever and ever. My butler had committed suicide. The Daily Telegraph in 1897. Oscar Wilde was asking for it. Shane McGowan of the Pogues. A man cannot be too careful in his choice of enemies. He picked the wrong enemy in the Marquess of Queensbury. If I hadn't my debts, I shouldn't have anything to think about. In the old days, men had the rack. Now they have the press. Rupert Everett, he was a Christ-like figure. Winston Churchill, the one person I am looking forward to meeting in the afterlife is surely Oscar Wilde. In prison, Oscar had much time for reflection. It was not just that prison was so much worse than he had imagined, with the hideous punishment of the treadmill, the inadequate food, the plank bed on which it was impossible to sleep, and the prohibition on speaking to other prisoners. Or even his realization that it was largely because of Bosie's vendetta against his father that he, Oscar, had to undergo such torment. The world shuts its gateway against me, and the door of love lies open. Oscar had complained several times that the prison authorities treated him cruelly. The doctor was particularly unkind. Any doctors in the audience? Only two? Okay. He was forbidden pencil and paper, except for writing a strict quota of letters, though he was allowed to read. The thing about Oscar Wilde, when he read a book, and he was sitting down one time at home, and he reads a book, but it's upside down, and he's just speed reading through the book, because he was such a genius. And his Constance came in, and she said, "Oscar, how can you do it? How can you retain such knowledge?" And Oscar replied, "Try me." The doctor is fighting for a theory. The man is fighting for his life. The Ballad of Reading Jail, my last piece of writing. It's about the cruelty of prison life and a man who had killed his wife in a crime of passion. He did not wear his scarlet coat, for blood and wine are red, and blood and wine were on his hands when he found them with the dead, the poor dead woman whom he loved and murdered in her bed. He walked amongst the trial men in a suit of shabby grey. A cricket cap was on his head, and his steps seemed light and gay. I never saw a man who looked with such a wistful eye. I never saw a man who looked at such a wistful day. Upon that little tent of blue, which prisoners called the sky, and at every drifting cloud that went, sails of silver by. Yet each man kills the thing he loves. By each let this be heard. Some do it with a bitter look, some with a flattering word. The coward does it with a kiss, the brave man with his sword. I signed that C-33, which was my prison number, on the first edition when it was printed, all the whispers around London. It's Oscar. It has to be Oscar. It's Oscar Wilde's work. It wasn't until the seventh edition that I allowed it to bore my name, Oscar Wilde. What happened to my poor, dear Constance?
He warned me that his determination to live by the pen made him a poor prospect for any woman. I should have listened, but I was blinded by his shining talent and utter genius until one day I came to realize that Oscar's shining success seemed to arouse rumours, awkward silences, and dark looks from friends and neighbours as they turned away from me in the street. They said that Oscar needed a wife to disprove the rumours of his unmanly tendencies. I believe Oscar never feigned attraction towards me that he did not feel. I believe Oscar married me because he loved me passionately and sincerely, just as I loved him. My spinal injury, despite surgery, has only worsened into what my doctor calls a crippling paralysis, which will gradually affect all my limbs. Now that my health suffers, I look back and wonder, should I have made a different choice? A better choice? I received the news at Babbicombe Cliff, where I had sought shelter with the only friend who still spoke to me. I returned home at once to learn that bankruptcy charges had been filed against Oscar, and his creditors would take everything he owned. Like a thief, I came at night, and I took as many as my clothes and the boys as I could fit into a carriage. The boys wondered why. We were asked to leave because the proprietor feared losing English patrons if our names were seen on the hotel register.
Poor Constance. She died in 1899. On her gravestone, it simply read, Constance Lloyd, sister of Otto Lloyd. I went to visit her grave, and it simply had Constance Lloyd. It never bore my name. I broke down at her grave when I saw it. Many years later, they added my name, wife of Oscar Wilde. I don't want to go to heaven, as none of my friends are there. Salome, my other great play, was banned. I wonder would my life have changed, as I wanted to go to France, but everybody urged me to stay. The only difference between the saint and the sinner is that every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. The Marquess of Queensberry had died on the 31st of January 1900, summing up just enough energy to spit in his second son Percy's face when Percy came to see him on his deathbed. Why would that not surprise me? In his will, he left £20,000 to Bosie. In today's money, millions and millions. Robbie Ross had urged Oscar to ask Bosie to settle some money on him, as Oscar had lavished Bosie with gifts and his fortune. Bosie said he needed the money. Oscar had said, he left me bleeding. On his last days in Paris, he was seen appearing from a laneway begging. And he said to this woman, I'm Oscar Wilde, I'm Oscar Wilde. She said, I know who you are, Oscar. And she'd emptied her purse and the tears rolled down her face. He could be seen in the rain, in the little boulevards and coffee shops with an empty cup of coffee. Bosie described him. He was like a fat old prostitute. And to think the English still haven't pardoned him. When he died, there was an envelope and a little pawn ticket where his little sister, aged 9, had died. Her name was Isola, and he'd written a little poem for her. Tread lightly, she is near, under the snow. Speak gently, she can hear the daisies grow. All her bright golden hair, tarnished with rust. She that was young and fair, fallen to dust. Coffin board, heavy stone, I vex my heart alone. Peace, peace, she cannot hear. All my life's buried here. You don't love someone for their looks or their clothes, but because they sing a song only you can hear. Like St. Francis of Assisi, I am wedded to poverty, but in my case, the marriage has not been a success, as I hate the bride that has been given to me and the rags I have been left to wear. Brendan Behan, another great Dublin playwright. My father used to drink with him in MacDade sometimes. Although Brendan Behan used to get thrown out, my father didn't. But he used to walk a little bit like that because he was drunk a lot of the time, or I guess like the drunk pretending. He's walking on glass to try and pretend that he's sober. But anyway, Good Morning America, Brendan Behan is a guest. And the show opens up and they say, Mr. Behan, what's it like to be in New York promoting your great play, Borstal Boy? And Brendan Behan says, and you're escorted down Fifth Avenue as well by two police officers. And Brendan Behan says, ah, Jesus, he says, normally in Dublin I'm handcuffed to them. Brendan Behan on Oscar. Sweet is the way of the sinner, sad is decked without God's ways. Good on you, Oscar, you had it both ways. There's no doubt that Oscar stood up to the bullies where others were able to flee to the continent in their green carnations, and he helped to expose the sexual and social hypocrisy, and for this we owe him a debt. Victim or villain, whatever we make of Oscar, it's hard not to be drawn to the drama of his destruction. It had to happen in the way that it did, almost like the story of Jesus, and it couldn't end any other way. Oscar's prison warder on Oscar. What the poet was before prison, I care not. What he may have been after he left prison, I know not. One thing I know, however, that while in prison, he lived the life of a saint, or as near that holy state of poor mortal that can ever hope to attain. Farewell, brave heart. May your sleep be as peaceful as your smile. May the angels hover around your tomb in death, as they hover around your tomb in life. The prison governor. Let us hope we shall someday see something really worthy of so brilliant and so unique a pen. One has to read but little to recognize what literature has lost in the death of a man like poor Oscar Wilde. All bad poetry springs from genuine feeling. Liam Neeson, my one ambition in life was always to play poor dear Oscar. 5 weeks before Oscar died, he had remarked to some visitors that he could never outlive the century, as the English would not stand for it. In the physical sense, his forecast was correct. But from the standpoint of his genius and reputation, he was outrageously off the mark, for he has not only outlived that century and the next, and seems destined to the same with those that follow. I guess Oscar is like the Beatles, Van Gogh, Pelé, Maradona. Genius always lives on. And the Sgt. Pepper album, John Lennon described him as his hero and the master of rebellion. And he's right beside John Lennon, if you look at the Sgt. Pepper album, which changed music. To live is the rarest thing in the world. Most people exist, that is all. November the 30th, 1900, the newspaper. Big picture of Oscar in his green carnation. You notice I'm wearing a red rose. The death is reported in Paris of the writer, Oscar Wilde, who had been living there since his release from prison under the name of Sebastian Melmoth. He picked that name. Melmoth comes from a novel called Melmoth the Wanderer. Wilde's career crashed in ruins when he was convicted of homosexual offences in 1895 and sentenced to 2 years penal servitude, which he described in The Ballad of Reading Gaol, published under the pseudonym C-33, his prison number. His stage successes, such as The Importance of Being Earnest, have remained unperformed since his disgrace. He died in poverty, dependent on the charity of his friends, and had become a Roman Catholic. Never love anyone who treats you like you are ordinary. Yes, I am a dreamer, for a dreamer is one who can only find his way by moonlight, and his punishment is that he sees the dawn before the rest of the world. Always forgive your enemies. Nothing annoys them so much. There is nothing more beautiful than to forget, except perhaps to be forgotten. I shall never make a new friend in my life, though perhaps a few after I die. Love's pleasure only lasts a moment. Love's sorrow lasts one's whole life. It is too delightful altogether, this display of fireworks at the end of my career. The dons are astonished beyond words that the bad Irish boy doing so well in the end. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce you to Wendy Walsh.
On the night before Oscar Wilde was released from jail, he heard a little girl crying in her cell. Oscar was very upset and paid her fine to have her released from jail. When Oscar came out of prison, he had the laws changed so children did not have to go to prison. Oscar was a very kind man. I sometimes go down to a statue and play in the playground designed after his children's story, The Selfish Giant. I like to read his children's stories. Oscar Wilde the Tooth Fairy came one night and gave me two goldfish, and I call them one and two. So if I lose one, I can keep two. Oscar Wilde the Tooth Fairy came another night and gave me two piglets, and I call them Rasher and Sausage. And I wish Oscar Wilde was alive today.
So what happened to Bosey, or that Bowsey? Well, he got married, he had a son, became celibate, and separated from his wife. He issued a pamphlet against Winston Churchill, libeling him, and he got 6 months in jail. An awful pity he didn't get 6 years. His two sons, Vivian and Cyril, they ended up in boarding school in Heidelberg in Germany, and they were real burdens to Constance's family. They were eventually separated, and Cyril was sent to the royal family in Monaco. His son Vivian was awarded the Order of the British Empire for bravery in 1919 and was discharged. Cyril was shot dead by a sniper, and he hadn't seen his older brother in over a year, and he was only a few hundred meters from them. How Oscar died. He got cerebral meningitis, although it's been rumored he had syphilis, but this is strongly denied by his family, his grandson Merlin Holland. He fell in prison and damaged his ear, and he died when he was age 46. Oscar, BBC News, 30th of November 2011, the headline, Oscar Wilde's restored tomb to be unveiled. He's buried in Paris with Jim Morrison from The Doors, Edith Piaf, No Regrets, The Little Sparrow, born in the streets of Paris to a prostitute. What's her name? Maria Callas, she's buried there. Victor Hugo of Les Mis, so I've no doubt they've great parties at night. The first time I was there, it took me a good while to find it. He was originally given a pauper's burial outside of Paris in a place called Bagneux, but then he was moved by an anonymous donor, and he is this massive, big, typical, him being the most flamboyant literary character of the last or any other century. Huge, big sculpture, covered in red lipstick, which some people in the room have seen it. And the first time I was there, I was heading down, I'd just come from Jim Morrison's grave, and I met two really attractive California girls, and being the obliging fella that I am, it surely helped them. So they wanted to know where Jim Morrison's grave was, and I said, Jim, I've just been there. We're going back up to Oscar Wilde. Oscar Wilde is buried here. I said, yeah, Jesus, we have to go and see Oscar Wilde. So sure enough, we went up. So as an Irish man, I felt very proud about that. But now the Irish government had to pay 50,000 euro, and there's a big glass barrier around the grave because it's completely full of women's kisses. Not a hope of that happening to my grave. Oscar, when he died, he went off on a 3-day bender of absinthe, and his friend Robbie Ross came. They knew he was very ill. The owner of the hotel, he had originally been thrown out of this other hotel, and the owner saw him and said, come, you can stay in my hotel. The Rolling Stones have stayed there many times. I've been in that hotel, and as you walk in, it's very tight, as most Parisian hotel rooms are, and this big purple painting of Oscar in his fur coat jumps out. I jump back, Jesus, what's that? The way he was staring at me, and there's photographs around the room, and there's his original bill, and his original bill is there, and he's lying down on the bed, and the doctor gives him the bill, and he looks at the doctor, and he says to the doctor, so I shall die as I lived, beyond my means. He looked up, and the last words out of his mouth were, my wallpaper and I are fighting a duel to the death. One or the other of us has to go. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to congratulate you all this evening on your great performance, which persuades me that you think almost as highly of this evening as I do myself.